Right.
Are we ready?
Yeah. Get ready, everybody, because it's time for the sing. 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 4. Sing dance. It's such a good dance.
I'm going to make a movie where somebody drowns somebody in a sink, and I'm going to have them say, get ready, everybody, because it's time for the sink.
Good.
Dance.
Do it. And then, like, as he's drowning, he's just, like, hitting him, like, 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 4. Sing dance. And then he just walks away, and he's like, sing dance.
All right. We right?
Yeah.
Let's just make a movie where you kill people, Cody. I'm just going to make a movie where you kill everybody.
Okay. It'll be called...
Cody Kills Everybody, the movie.
The game. The soundtrack.
Welcome to WMVG, the weekly Multivarious Games podcast. I'm Chris, joined by Cody.
Water is good.
And Tom, is that my water? No, it's
my water.
It's your trunk water?
Yeah, it's my trunk water.
This is episode 81 of WMVG.
Can we explain trunk water, or else it's going to sound really weird?
Sure.
Or should we just...
Sure, go for it.
This is water I keep in my trunk, so we call it trunk water.
He always has water in his trunk.
Yeah. I thought it was because it was water you pulled it out of your ass.
I tried once.
Okay.
It didn't taste too well. I was like, you know, maybe it'll just...
It didn't taste too well?
Yeah. You know, maybe the flavors will just kind of absorb out. No.
Awesome. Anyway, episode 81.
Yeah.
We're getting up there. I was thinking about it.
We're doing stuff.
We're going to hit 100 this year.
We should do a party.
Yeah.
And have everybody... We'll just get, like, 2 Yeti mics, and then we'll just get as many people as we can on the podcast.
Shift them through like rapid, like you get one question.
No, like everybody just gathers around the room.
Oh god, that sounds awful. We're not doing that.
And then we live stream it.
That sounds terrible.
We answer comments in the live stream.
Cool. Yeah, we're getting there. So by the end of the year, we'll be at 100. But right now we're at 81, so we're not quite there yet.
Yeah.
We're also recording this one kind of late because this has been a heck of a week. But
we had no internet this morning. That was fun.
That was cool.
So this will probably be up like late Thursday night. So, it's late Thursday afternoon.
That's nice. Like on time.
Well, I'll be leaving here shortly, so the iMac will be ready for you.
Yep. It takes like an hour just to transfer over the video files from the server to the iMac, though.
Where are you going, Chris? Where are you
going?
Why
don't you just use a... Like a USB or something? There's no way it takes as long to do it direct.
Like 40 minutes... through server or like 30 minutes through hard drive last time I tried it.
That is ridiculous.
Yep.
Where are you going that's so important, Chris?
It's game U.
It's game U!
Ew. Are you going to teach kids how to make games?
Yeah. Always do.
How many kids have made a game yet?
7.
At game U?
Yeah.
I don't know. I mean, there were 5 or 6 teams last year at the Expo showcasing.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
7.
I must have missed the game.
Do you know that for sure? You're just being a jackass.
Let's be honest. Which one do we think it is?
Also, baby is here. She's giving kisses right now.
Hi, baby.
Hi, sweet pea. All right. So let's do some housekeeping. So episode 81. We will do something for episode 100, but we still got a little while.
Yeah.
But keep that in the back of your brain. Now we're going to do something. I'd like to do some kind of like live event if we could.
Yeah.
I think that'd be really cool. I did not look at when that week would be. What do we have, 19?
I'll pull up a calendar and we can just...
Yeah, let's take a look at it.
Let's take a look.
Necessarily be that week, but at least we'll have a rough gauge.
I got to do some quick mathematical magic of pulling up a calendar.
And if it doesn't work out, we can always skip a week. And
yeah, because it's also going to be coinciding roughly when we're in high gear for the Expo, so we may need to shuffle some things around. But
yeah.
We could have the 100th episode be at the Expo.
Year 2016 calendar. Look at that. All right, so.
Where are we?
It is April 14th.
Okay.
So 81, 82, 83, 84, 85, 86, 87.
This is really optimistic.
88, 89, 90, 91, 92, 93, 94, 95, 96, 97, 98, 99, 100.
August 25th.
That is Kate's birthday.
I'll be moved into my new house for a whole week and a half.
Yeah. So there you go.
I'll be doing exactly what I'm doing now, but it'll be warmer.
The week of August 25th okay. should be when episode 100.
Thereabouts. But we'll do some, so we'll keep you updated. The next thing that we got cooking is that a lot of the team's going to be at PAX East next week. So if you're listening and you're going to be at PAX East and you want to hang out with us or chat with us or whatever,
yeah,
just email us, let us know.
I should probably grab that.
And we can... it's kind of crazy town at PAX, so can't guarantee anything, but if there's some parties or dinners or lunches or whatever, we can figure some stuff out. Yeah, there's a cool restaurant in the hotel, or not the hotel, it is the hotel connected to the convention center, but that place is usually like crazy full. But it's a Irish joint. It's pretty good.
Is it called the Irish
joint? An Irish joint Boston?
I don't remember what it's called.
What?
Yeah.
Yeah.
We went to the that other Irish place.
O'Flanahan's.
Is that what it was? The first night on Thursday?
McGinnis Cuddies.
Oh, for the love of God. I was so tired when we rolled into Boston last year.
You guys rolled in at like what? It would have been
We left at 5. Yeah. And we got in at 5 in the morning and we got there at like 7:30, 7, yeah. something like that.
I'm happy we're flying this year.
Oh. Yeah. Flying's the way to go.
We were also going in the opposite direction of the sun, so... We went forward in time. No, we didn't because we're Eastern Standard the whole way.
Yeah.
But realistically, we did. Even though we stayed in the same time zone, we went ahead like maybe a half an hour.
Yeah.
No, we didn't because time is a made-up human concept.
Chris, don't start this conversation again.
Okay.
It's a real time sink.
What's the time?
It's really the time sink. Yeah, I got it.
It's time to take a bath.
I was graciously ignoring it.
Chris,
so we can move on.
Look at the juxtaposition between our shoes here. Yeah. It's almost like you're the boss, I'm the lowly...
We're wearing pretty much the same shoes, like black, gray,
yeah.
white laces.
But like a blue stripe, but mine are filthy and squalid when yours are immaculate.
Well, I've only had these for 2 weeks, so give it time.
Yeah. Mine are socks.
All right. The last thing for our housekeeping. Well, actually, not the last thing. We are doing prototype and play at our office on Friday.
Yeah.
And at the same time, Ludum Dare is this weekend, so we're going to have kind of like a little...
We're going to have a launch party.
Yeah, for people who want to come, meet up, chit-chat. Have we let people know about that?
I probably won't be there. I'll probably go to Sydney.
That's a good story.
Do it. But yeah, prototype and play. It's
You're
on Friday.
Miss my party on Saturday.
That's a sad one.
That is a sad one.
I got a text from Sam, our photographer, and she's just like, "How did I get invited to some PJ party and what is it?" And I was just like, "Oh, it's one of Chris's parties, and I don't know. I guess someone likes you.
She should come."
Yeah, that's what I told her.
It's a good time. So anyway, Friday at our office. If you want to be a part of Ludum Dare or you just want to come to Prototype and play, that's happening. Was that 7? Is that when we're starting?
6:30.
Okay. Then the final thing is we have opened the Patreon. We've mentioned that before, but it is now officially live and taking donations or what? How do you, just taking patrons?
So yeah. Yeah.
Whatever you call it.
You can be a patron.
So. I want to give a very sort of special and heartfelt thanks out to Robert and to Sean, who are our first two patrons.
Yeah, Sean.
Yay, you guys are the best.
And Sean who?
Sean Arata.
Sweet. Thanks, Sean.
Yeah. So we really appreciate it. I know we're just getting started, so we're going to hopefully, as our fans and stuff build up, we'll be able to bring in more. But like every dollar, it doesn't seem like a lot, but every dollar helps because it's just all of the stuff we do, all of the... Ludum Dare and Prototype and Play and COG and the Expo and hackathons, like it doesn't seem like much, I guess, but they all cost money.
They all cost more money than you'd expect.
Yeah, everything always costs more than you'd expect, and by having this going and being able to get money from everyone in the community, that'll allow us to kind of pool these resources together to start doing more and more cool things. So more events. We want to start doing a monthly, like, just bar meetup where people can come and after work and just relax and chat about games and the gaming community.
Totally.
We want to start getting some speakers in for some of our meetings, start doing more hackathons.
we want to get like an actual camera so that we can not only record things like this much better, but also we want to start using it to record COG so that we can get all of our presentations.
And look how terrible this is lined up. How centered.
Yeah, I don't know how that got so bad.
Anyway, and then we also want to start expanding into our online presence.
Making it worse. Making it worse.
There we go. That's kind of better, I guess. This whole room is an absolute travesty.
You should have done the King Zora sound effect.
I don't think I understand your reference.
Ooh-wee.
All right.
That's the best we're getting.
Cody, you're not playing Ocarina of Time yet?
Oh, okay.
King Zora. Oh, yeah. God.
I've played Ocarina of Time. We
Call
talked about this.
Call yourself a gamer in my presence again. I'm going to get real mad.
Gamer. Tom, I like to play video games.
You still haven't called yourself a gamer.
Therefore, I am a gamer.
All right, now you're making me mad.
All right, anyway. But yeah, we want to start expanding our online presence, and we have a couple cool ideas for that, but that's going to be farther down the road once we can...
I actually haven't seen the goals yet for the page.
Welcome to the Space Jam.
I think you can only see the first two, right? Is that how... You can see like what's been met in the next one?
You can... Yeah, I guess there's a little... I think these are the only ones that we have so far, aren't they?
Starts to level quality video equipment.
But anyway, it's all part of the long-term plan to just keep adding... Yeah. Oh, there we go. Adding more and more...
We have plenty cool of ideas. We're just kind of messing around.
We should be recording COG meetings or something. At least the COG presentations.
We have no way of doing it right now. Unless if we were to like bring this web camera with us.
I wish I went to COG more. I've been just too busy. But COG is always cool. Like, people are doing neat things over there.
Yeah.
The biggest pain with trying to record COG is everybody's switching laptops out and stuff. Yeah. So it's like all these different computers. But we can figure it out. With your support, we can do cool stuff.
Figure it out.
And again, thank you, Robert and Sean. We really, really, really appreciate it.
You guys are the best.
A few more people like them and we will have.
You start. You go step by step, you know, and like MVG, we're going on year 6 here, which is kind of mind-blowing.
Yeah.
It's just literally step by step.
Finally in those...
And trying not to cry too much.
Getting in those adolescent years.
Still cry a little bit.
Yeah. Okay, we're done with housekeeping.
Yeah.
Let's move on.
First thoughts. So, do you guys know about itch.io?
Itch.io.
Yes. I've heard of it.
So just as kind of a refresher, itch.io is essentially a kind of a Steam, it's a storefront, right? It's a digital game storefront where it's mainly used by indie developers because they don't really have too many restrictions on how to get in. You just, you know, put it in. So, for example, Tadpole Interactive, a local developer, it's a one-man show, Jesse Han, right? That's his last name, right?
Mm-hmm.
Jesse. He publishes all of his games on itch.io and makes money, and they have bundles through that.
I think there's an article about itch.io in that GDC, or that Game Developer magazine we keep in the bathroom.
Oh, is there?
Yeah, from 2013, like when they were first starting.
Sounds about right. but anyway, as a April Fool's joke, right, so this is a couple weeks ago, they decided to put an app up on Steam Greenlight that was essentially just like, you know, you'll be able to access our store through Steam. And everyone's just like, oh, ha ha ha, April Fool's, whatever, they'll pull it down. They have not pulled it down yet. So it's starting to speculate that, no, itch.io is going to try to get its own app onto Steam, which is great. And so it's kind of just one of those cool kind of technologies of like, you know,
are they going to allow that though?
But yeah, I saw that on the sidebar. It said Valve blocks competition. You may also like Valve blocks competition.
Oh, there we go. So this has been updated. Oh yeah, this was right after I made the
click on it and see what it says.
So it looks like Valve has blocked itch.io from putting their app on Steam.
I was going to say, I could not see Valve allowing another distributor to use their network.
I like the idea of it, though, because, like, if you think about it, like, itch.io is just, like, they're doing, like, kind of the indie thing. I mean, I guess it's no different than, like, just installing a launcher onto your computer. The difference is that you can launch your launcher from within a launcher.
And you can already...
Yeah, but it's like Apple and Google don't allow it either. Like, you can't have your own app store within their app
Google
store.
Google does.
Right? I guess people...
I don't think they do.
Yeah, Amazon App Store.
But that's a that's not being sold through Google Play.
Yeah, it is.
The Amazon App Store?
The Amazon App Store you download from Google Play.
What?
Yeah.
That's got to be new because they...
That it's been around for ages.
I know the Amazon App Store has, but I'm saying that rule has got to be different.
I don't know. I just know that I downloaded the Amazon App Store years ago through Google Play.
Because there was a whole big thing about both Google and Apple. Because otherwise you can create, you can download, you can put up an app for free, mm-hmm. and then you charge all of the content. So you put up the app, mm-hmm. download that app, the user opens that app, and then all the content is then charged through that app, which means Google and Apple make no money. So like newspapers and stuff were trying to circumvent that by being like, you can download our app for free, but once you're in the app, you have to pay the subscription or service mm-hmm. fee. And so they were getting around the...
Wasn't that Apple's magazine?
Well, now... Newsstand? Yeah, now they have Newsstand and stuff. But, I mean, Newsstand's just an app.
Yeah.
Distribution thing. That's what it is. But, yeah, maybe Google has opened it up since then. But, I mean, now you can do, like, subscriptions and stuff. But I could just see it being, like, a real pain in the ass what it's like... You know, you download something through itch.io, and then all of a sudden Valve's getting all these things like, I want to return my game. And they're like, what game are you talking about? And they're like, I want to return Assassin's Creed 3 or whatever. And they're like, you didn't buy that through here. Well, I bought it through itch. And we're like, well, go talk to itch. We're like, but I downloaded it through Steam. Or like,
well, go talk to itch.
Well, go talk to itch. Like, that's not our problem.
Yeah, exactly. It's not their problem.
Well,
I guess, I'm saying just it just becomes a pain.
I guess people can always, you know, ironically... register their launcher as an executable through Steam. I did it with
I think that's what they're doing.
I did it with Origin.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Just say add a non-Steam product and you like put on the Origin launcher because I thought it would be funny.
I went in and added all of the games that the Origin launcher launches into Steam so that I could just not use the Origin launcher.
Oh boy.
I don't know if you can still do that, but yeah, I had SimCity installed on.
I hate the Origin launcher.
Yeah, it's bad. So I had, when I was playing SimCity, I just installed that into Steam and then just bypassed Origins.
That's why they call it the O-Ragin launcher, because it makes you rage.
Nobody calls it
how bad it is. Nobody calls it that.
Nobody in the world calls it
that. Except for me just now. Now the word is out. It exists.
Yeah.
It,
but anyway, I think the idea of it's cool, but yeah, I don't ever see it happening.
It was funny. I mean, yeah, that's just the thing where an April Fool's joke becomes, well, let's see if they let it happen.
I don't see the Amazon App Store on here. There's the Amazon app.
That has the Amazon App Store on it. So, like, hold on. Where's my phone?
I mean, I believe you.
Yeah.
But this is the Amazon store, like for normal folks or whatever.
No, but the Amazon store on Android, right? So if I go to like Amazon, right?
Yeah.
You can click Amazon. I wish I had a way of showing this to everybody else. So you click on Amazon and
you're on
then
the
you
web
go,
now, right? Are you in the store?
No, this is the app. And then you can just click apps. And then these are so they have their underground service where essentially you get free apps for you can get apps for free, like underground completely free. You get all the DLC for free as well. But you can also just go in and, like, I could buy AVG Antivirus Pro for Android on Amazon.
So that must be how they're sort of getting away with it, is that it's part of the Amazon total
app
experience.
That was something that they just did, like, a month ago, though.
Okay.
Like, they just... Before then, it was its own app, though. There was an app called Amazon App Store.
I remember, because I was trying to... configure my grandma's ancient Android tablet that she got. And yeah, it was like, you need to download the Amazon App Store from the Google Play App Store. And I'm like, what?
Yeah, it was a thing. And then the big reason why I downloaded Amazon App Store is because they'd give one free app a day. It was just random apps that they would give you one free a day.
It's like Starbucks, where they give you like a song a day and an app a day or a week. And they all generally are not very good.
Yeah. They weren't, but there was a couple of decent ones. And then Amazon just kind of took that philosophy and said, you know what, instead of doing different ones each day, we're just going to sign on developers and get a catalog going of just free apps. So, like, I downloaded, like, Cut the Rope for free and have, like, infinite power-ups and money or whatever because they don't charge when you buy stuff. It just, it comes up as zero. So, like, it's like, was $9.99, now zero. Was $100, now zero. It's cool. But yeah, Amazon's had their own app store since, I mean, that was when I was in middle school. It was when they launched that.
for my, it was on my first Android.
Cool. Well,
it's been a thing.
That's weird that your first smartphone was in middle school.
I think it might have been in like early high school.
I remember having a pager in high school. A Mountain Dew pager that I got for free.
A Mountain Dew pager.
As part of a Mountain Dew promotion.
That's awesome.
Yeah, it was sweet. I got a free pager and like 2 or 3 years worth of service for free as part of this promotion.
Hmm. Did you like drink a bunch of Mountain Dew?
I wonder if I still have that pager.
Mountain Dew.
Because it had like a little Mountain Dew logo on it and stuff.
Yeah.
It was cool.
I'd use it.
Yeah.
I'd use a Mountain Dew pager. And yeah, no, I lied. I got my first.
I don't even know if you can get service for it anymore.
I got my first Android in high school. I didn't even get my first phone until I was in 8th grade. So
I didn't get my first phone until I was like 20. No. How old would I have been?
What was your non-phone Android?
I probably got a cell phone in late high school, I think.
Was it just like
a... I had one of the old Nokias, like the gray ones that were all one unit. That phone was fucking sweet, though.
Those phones are great. Like, you could just throw it and it'd be fine.
It was just simple. Like, even though it was, like, the green and black screen and, like, the menu was very simple, but that was nice because, like, I could get to my contacts super fast. Like, I could get to text messages super fast. And granted, I had to do the keyboard, you know,
like click it numeric like three key times.
Texting system, so people didn't really text a lot. But it was just super fast. Like, I'd just be like, hey, I need to call home. Boom. Damn.
Yeah.
What, was your Android that wasn't a phone?
No. Like, my first Android phone I got when I was in high school.
But you said you didn't even get your first phone until later.
No. I got my first phone in middle school, and I got my first Android in high school.
Oh, okay.
Is that my first phone was like a Nokia brick, gotcha. And then I had...
Okay. I thought you said you got your first phone after your first Android.
No. That's weird. That's really weird. Because, yeah, I got I got, like, the Droid 2. When that was a thing.
Never mind.
Until then, I had a flip phone. I miss flip phones. Is that weird? Tom, I know that you just got rid of yours, but...
I didn't get rid of it. I still have it.
Well, like, you just switched from a flip phone.
Yeah. It doesn't get data anymore, so it's pretty much useless, but I still have it. And once I migrated my contacts off of it, I really had no use for it at all. But I still have to make sure that I got all my photos off it before I, like, dispose of it. Mm-hmm. Who knows? I might keep it anyway.
Cool.
I like flip phones. I always thought they were cool. Like,
there's a little paperweight. I could just turn it into a percussion instrument because it's got that little, I can get like nice triplets when I'm with it. Yeah, like a little mini.
I've been going through all my photos lately because I'm trying to get back into photography, and it's crazy. I'm going through all my photos since the very first iPhone.
Yeah.
So since 2007, I've got thousands upon thousands of photos.
Oh my goodness.
Shot on the original iPhone. And they're like real small too.
Oh,
like, real grainy, but it's awesome.
That's awesome.
Anyway.
That was itch.io.
That was itch.io on Steam.
Let's
jump to... I want to talk about the PS4.5.
Well, way to just jump to the bottom.
Well, that's why I wanted you to rearrange, but you said, don't worry about it, because we can skip around.
Yeah.
So I'm skipping around.
I had a good leeway, damn it!
Fine. So, your leeway, and then we're still going
to
jump. So.
Yes, 4.5. That's fine. That's Sony's butthurt reaction to the new Nintendo console.
Yeah, you missed that podcast. It was great. Well, I was going to say, Tom, we were talking about code injection and getting Flappy Bird on Super Mario last week, right? That's not the only place where Flappy Bird has been, because now you can play Flappy Bird on an e-cig.
Wow.
That's going to be really hard.
That's stupid.
Flappy Bird on an e-cig.
I shouldn't say it's stupid, but...
I mean, it's funny enough, but yep, that's the thing.
Now, the only way this would be interesting to me is if every time you went through it, it put out a little burst of smoke to the e-cig.
And that's the only way how you can smoke?
That's the only way.
That you have to play Flappy Bird?
Yeah, and it's like part of a tobacco, like, stop smoking campaign, like, force you to play Flappy Bird.
Have you guys seen the thing about popcorn lung?
No.
That doesn't sound good, though.
I've heard of popcorn lung.
Apparently, e-cigarettes are like...
There are certain e-cigarette fluids that contain a bad chemical that gives you popcorn lung, right? Like, that's basically...
I don't know how many. It looks like it's a pretty large scale. It has to do with the technology, not necessarily the liquid.
Yeah. What is popcorn?
Was it like it's like debilitating, uncurable lung disease?
Was it like people
caused by?
Was it like people like overcooking this, like torching the fluid too hard?
Or? I don't think so. I think it's just here, popcorn lung.
Because I think I saw it was like something Wiki. Like it doesn't affect all Like, it only affects, like, a pretty comprehensive
bronchiolitis
subset.
Obliterans, also called blah, 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 is a rare, life-threatening form of non-reversible obstructive lung disease. Where are we? In which the bronchioles are... There's so many friggin' parentheses in this thing. In which the bronchioles are compressed and narrowed by fibrosis and or inflammation. Yeah. So it's like every time they say a term, they talk about what it means. Industrial inhalants.
Surely cigarette smokers can also suffer from popcorn lung.
Let's see if they mention popcorn lung e-cigs. But anyway, don't smoke anyway. Just don't do it.
Flappy lung.
Oh, was it like one of those Facebook myths?
I don't know. I just went to Snopes for fun.
Yeah.
But it's, I don't know.
Okay. Well, anyway.
Unless you want popcorn.
Good stuff. Don't smoke. Bad for you.
Yeah.
Spend your money on other shit.
Like video games.
Yep.
Like.
Or the PlayStation 4.5. Okay, now go.
Sweet. So you guys talked about this a little bit.
Yeah.
A little bit.
And I didn't listen at all.
In the context of it being a cheap ripoff of Nintendo's new console, yeah.
How is it a cheap ripoff?
Oh, I was just making a point. It's like Nintendo announces their new console is going to have 4K. It's the first video game console with 4K. And then suddenly Sony's like, hey, we got a 4K console coming out just about the same time. Yeah. So I'm like, oh, wow, Sony. It's just like when they ripped off the Wiimote and just like when they... all the other times Nintendo has done something and Sony's hopped on it and Microsoft's probably going to hop on it too. Are you going to see the Xbox 1.5?
There's actually, there were news reports of new Xbox SKUs like kind of in the works with an NDA of June 26th. So like right after E3. So I'm sure we're just going to see like the normal slim consoles for both of them.
I mean,
I don't believe that. A little looking here, NX to support 900p 60fps 4K streaming, but not 4K.
The PS 4.5 can't do 4K gaming either. It just upscales.
Well, nobody knows what the PS 4.5 can do because it doesn't exist.
Well, allegedly, it can't do 4K gaming. Does
the PS4 can do 4K output?
It can do 4K streaming, but it can't do gaming. So sure. What they're saying, the insider sources or whatever, are saying that the PS4K, PS4.5, can take, you know, games and upscale them to 4K, but it won't be able to actually play games in 4K. Like, we're just not... The article I was reading about it was essentially, like, we're just not there technology-wise and affordability-wise to have 4K in a home console yet. Because just, like, currently, you can only really run 4K on a computer for gaming, and you have to have, like... dual SLI like titans to do it and to do it well.
Sure.
And so we don't have that technology quite available yet. But regardless, I mean,
I don't, yeah, I, there's been nothing in, I mean, everybody, there's nothing about anything about this yet.
Yeah, totally.
Anyway,
there's no official
word. But there's really been nothing that says like this is actually going to be a legitimate 4K system.
Yeah.
I'm not so much concerned about, I don't have a 4K TV. Most of the content, even if you have a 4K PS4, like, most of the games will not be in 4K.
Yeah,
right.
Like, I just can't imagine, like, you know, these games are taking up 40, 50, 60 gigabytes as it is.
Yeah,
at
4K.
1080p. Yeah, you jump that up to 4K, and I'm like, Jesus Christ, you're 300, 400, 500.
Yeah, because hypothetically, a 4K game, I mean, just from a resolution, is at least four times the resolution. So we can play it on the safe side and say three times the game size, and you're looking at 150, 200 gigs.
Yeah,
for a game.
Yeah, but what I'm more interested in, and this is like I've been listening to everybody talk about this thing, but I'm more interested in the business model of it. Whereas, is Sony going to create a device that comes out every 3 or 4 years, mm-hmm. and just get rid of, like, it's no longer called PS4 or PS5; it's just PlayStation. And there's always, like, you know, let's say they don't release it this year. This is the third year, right? Like, we're entering...
We're into the third year, yeah.
Yeah.
Because it launched in...
So let's just say, for the sake of fun, that they release it next year. They're going to do it every 4 years. Every 4 years, they release a new PlayStation. They cut the SKU on the current PlayStation and just sell out that stock as it goes away. And then you have a new PlayStation, and that's the only one you buy. Like, that's the only one you can get, but it's more powerful than the previous generation, just like your phone.
Yeah.
You know, you just, every year you get, you know, your iPhone 5, 5S, 6, 6S, whatever.
Well, with that thought, though, wouldn't they keep on the naming, though? Because, like, in the same way where, like...
Well, they would change the naming convention in some way.
Yeah.
But I'm just saying, like, just have the PlayStation ecosystem.
Yeah.
And that's it. And don't sell, once you release PlayStation, whatever it is, PlayStation Next, you don't manufacture or sell any more PlayStation 4s. So you release the next PlayStation at $400, the other one gets price cut down to $250 or whatever until stock run out. And you just do that every 4 years. But the nice thing with that is that every game would be playable forever.
Yeah.
Theoretically. You know, as long as you kept the architecture and the graphic systems the same, it would be like your phone, where when you buy The Witness for the PlayStation 4 in 2020, when the next iteration, like the third iteration of this comes out or whatever, then you can still play The Witness.
Yeah.
Because they're all within that ecosystem.
I'm interested. I mean, like, it's the idea of that isn't too much further off of what we currently have, with the exception of, like, currently, those are, you know, 8 year cycles or whatever. You know, like last year was, or last year.
Except you can't play any of the old stuff yet.
Well,
it's changing a bit.
It's changing, yeah. And if we look at, I mean, and that's changed up until this generation, right? Like, backwards compatibility has almost always been a thing up until now.
What are you talking about? Backward compatibility has almost never been a thing. Nintendo, every time you bought a new Nintendo console, none of that was backwards compatible.
I guess, yeah, Nintendo is the exception.
The only backwards compatibles were Xbox 360 to Xbox original for a bit,
kind of.
And the PlayStation 3 could play PlayStation 2 games for a little bit.
So PlayStation 3 could play PlayStation 2 games for a sec, and they've always been able to play PlayStation 1 games. And PlayStation 2 games can play PlayStation 1 games.
I'm sorry, did you just say PlayStation 3 can play all PlayStation 1 games, but no PlayStation, like, not all PlayStation 2 games?
I can...
Well, the original version of the PS3 had, like, a backwards compatibility emulation chip in it.
Oh.
That was cut pretty early in the cycle to save money.
I could be wrong, I could be misremembering, but I'm pretty sure PlayStation 3 can play PlayStation 1 games. Maybe that's just a really dumb kind of thought.
Is PlayStation 2 backwards compatible? I don't think it is.
PlayStation 2 can play PlayStation 1 games.
All of them or just a subset?
Are you sure?
All of them. Yeah, I'm positive. Yeah, PlayStation 2 can play PlayStation 1 games. And when I think of Nintendo, I think of Game Boy, where up until the DS has always been completely backwards compatible. The GBA could play anything from Game Boy Color to original Game Boy.
But you can't talk the... So that's one handheld device out of the history of games?
No, I mean, like, we just talked about PlayStation, Xbox, the Game Boy. Like, yeah, Nintendo, you're right.
But
Nintendo,
the Xbox stopped doing it. It was, backwards compatibility was not a thing until, like, the early 2000s with the Xbox and PlayStation 2. It wasn't even a thing. Like, the idea that you could, your next console would play your old games just did not exist. It's a newer idea than it is an older idea.
Yeah, I mean, I'll give you that. Yeah, and I mean, I don't know my, like, super, you know, old console history too much outside of, like, you know, I had a Genesis, which I'm pretty sure Genesises can't play Master System, but I could be wrong.
Well, the Genesis was kind of a monstrosity anyway, where everything was built under this core kind of structure with the CD and the 32X. And
Sega does what Nintendo.
Yeah, well, we saw that.
Yeah.
But anyway, like, outside of that discussion or whatever, just being able to have games treated more like apps in the sense that they're tethered to your account, it'll be on your Xbox or PS account forever. And if sometime in 2028 you want to go back and play The Last of Us, you can just download that app and play it, and it works.
Yeah.
You know?
I think the biggest problem of me being, like, if I'm playing pessimist right now, you know, I'm playing devil's advocate, is that I can play The Last of Us right now because they reported it and made money off of the same game twice.
Sure.
And this model disincentivizes that because it makes it impossible.
Well, they're gonna have to,
but there's also a cost associated with that.
Yeah, totally.
They're not just like, hey, let's bring The Last of Us out on PS4, and they just like push a button. Like, they had to have a studio go through and rework the entire thing.
But that cost is significantly cheaper than making a new game.
Sure, but I bet that over the long run, that cost would have worked out if it was just, hey, here's The Last of Us, and instead of The Last of Us having a 3 or 4 year lifespan, it has a 20-year lifespan.
Yeah.
You know, just think about, like, talk about Chrono Trigger, for example. Like, you know, there's some remakes of Chrono Trigger on the PS and everything, and mm-hmm. now it's out on the eShop mm-hmm. to purchase. But, like, just have it be that way forever. Like, Chrono Trigger comes out, you buy it, you think it's awesome. Chrono Trigger comes out, you don't buy it. 5 years later, someone's like, hey, you should play Chrono Trigger, and you can go back and easily purchase it. You don't need to wait for Nintendo to come up with an HD version to work on the system you happen to be using.
No, I mean, like, the idea is there. I agree. I think it'd be cool.
Yeah, look at
Nintendo can't even get eShop purchases between the 3DS and the Wii U.
Yeah, well, that's
like, let's get 1 point.
I just think in the long run, these companies are going to make more money because, yes, of course, re-releasing The Last of Us for PS4 means people bought The Last of Us for PS4.
Yeah.
And I don't know what the breakdown is between people who bought that game for the first time and people like us who bought it again. But I'd be willing to bet that over the long run, it would just be easier and earn you more money to just have The Last of Us there and people just keep picking up. You and I will never rebuy it because we already have it tethered to our account. But everybody else who's never played it will buy it, and Sony doesn't have to do a goddamn thing.
Future generations.
Yeah,
yeah, it's just there. You know, every kid who's 14 now and their mommies wouldn't let them buy The Last of Us because it's a mature game, you know, in college, they'll be like, I really heard about this game. I'm going to go buy it, you know. Yeah.
Also, it'll keep them from having to call the next remake something else because they already used HD. They'll have to call it Ultra HD, Mega HD.
Last of Us. Called The Last of Us Remastered.
Remastered, yeah. Last of Us Remastered Director's Cut.
Yeah.
Remastered.
Yeah.
I just want The Last of Us Remastered.
I just like the idea of having, as long as the refresh cycles for the devices aren't too quick, you know, like, I think 1 or 2 years is absolutely, like, I'm not going to pay $400 every 2 years.
Like, why are they, like, jumping on the, like, give it a couple more years? I think it's because Nintendo's trying to be in that halfway cycle, and PlayStation's like, nah.
Yeah.
You can't have that whole halfway cycle to yourself. We're going to get in on that, too.
Yeah. I think it would be really cool. Every 4 years, maybe every 3 years. You know, I spend like $200 on a new phone every 2 years. But my phone's like a part of me, you know?
Yeah.
I use
Mine's
it all the time.
Slowly becoming a part of me.
I know. You have to sort of learn the process of putting your phone away and not looking at it.
I've already I've already kind of, in some ways I've surrendered to it just like by putting all my contacts on it and all that. I'll probably like go through and add addresses for all the contacts and go through and just go quickly go insane. I almost said slowly.
Slowly.
It's gonna happen fast.
It's gonna happen real fast.
Then I'll be like, I won't be able to live without it. So I'll have to like put it under my skin so I never lose it. So I have like the iPhone right there. Yeah.
My phone's bigger than my wrist, so that would be weird.
Yeah.
But I think that would be neat. That would be very exciting. Every 4 years, a new device comes out.
Cody, don't.
Oh, God. Oh, God. I like big phones.
This is reasonable right here.
And if the Vita was cross-playable with that, now we're...
Nobody would ever play the Vita.
Now we're into something. That's not true. We talk all the time about how we play stuff on the Vita.
Yeah.
Just because it's mobile. Like, there's lots of games... that I have on my PS4 that if they were on the Vita, I would play them. But I have not even cracked them. Even the Uncharted collection, like, the Uncharted games are the kind of games I want to play on the big screen. Mm-hmm. But given the place I am now where it's like, what is this, the 14th, it comes out the 10th? So I've got less than a month to beat Uncharted 2 and 3. I would I would easily play that game on.
Chris, you know you can do that?
On Golden Abyss, which I platinumed.
No, not on Golden Abyss. But do you want to know how you can beat those games in less than a month?
How can I do that?
Play them on regular.
No.
As they should be played.
I'm
half. Play them on. I'm about to beat Uncharted 3.
I'm halfway to through 2.
Chris, in the time that it took me to get a quarter of the way through 2, I have completely beaten 2 and are halfway through 3.
Well, I'm also really busy, Cody.
I am too.
I'm doing a lot of things. I'm working here.
I am too.
Are you?
You're the one who platinumed The Witness.
Hell yeah, I did. And Persona.
Yeah.
Anyway, I think it can be a neat business model. Everybody's like up in arms about how I don't want to buy a new thing. I think this is going to be terrible. But I think if your games work forever, as long, you know, tethered to your account, this seems like an awesome thing to me. Like imagine if your DualShock 4s keep working and your peripherals keep working, just as the device itself becomes more and more powerful every year, like that'd be wicked sweet.
Yeah, it's hardware agnostic software.
Yeah, and I don't think it'll be. There's people who are like, well, developers are gonna have to customize stuff. I think people are looking at it too much like a PC. Instead of a phone. You know, people are like, well, you get a new PC and it's like all these different graphics cards and it's a pain in the ass for developers to work on. It's true, like, it's a pain in the ass to develop PC games because of all the different hardware combinations that can occur. Like, it just takes so much time to do it. And no one's immune, even, like, we're talking about The Witness. I was listening to Jonathan Blow and he said he spent, like, the 2 months after The Witness came out just fixing various PC issues for all these different things. But, you know, if you look at it more like a phone, where it's like, yeah, it's different internals, but Sony has tested them and made sure that they all conform to what is supposed to happen for an app requirement, then you're good. And if anything happens to break, then with the ability to digitally push stuff, developers can just go in and kind of fix it real fast. But it's unlikely to happen. I mean, we're testing Hatchet on, what, 5 different phones right now? And besides some, like, really underpower issues, seems to be working.
Were there ever, probably not. I don't remember hearing about, like, back in the days of cartridges and like, early CD times before there were, like, online consoles. What happened if they release a cartridge and they were like, oh, there's a bad crash bug, like
there was a bad
then you owned a game that was unplayable.
Did they ever do any like recalls? Like we'll ship you a patched cartridge.
I'm sure. I don't have any that come to mind. But
here's the big difference, right? Is that Sega and Nintendo were like rigorous in their testing, and they would deny you. You know, they'd set you back a month. Because they'd be testing your game for a month, and if they found the smallest bug like that, they wouldn't let you.
And now they're getting lazy with that because they can just patch it.
Yeah, because it can be patched later. So both like the kind of certification process as well as the developer process is
kind
just
of
getting
shifted over to the end user.
Yeah. That's that was the reason why you don't. I'm sure they've had it a couple times, but yeah, I remember there was a video about it that I watched probably a couple years ago. And yeah, like, it was super rigorous testing.
Yeah. Here's a list of banned games.
I looked up. We should have a banned game episode.
I mean, you got to keep in mind, like, particularly Nintendo, Sega wasn't the same, but Nintendo owned the manufacturing process for cartridges. So it's like, if you wanted to put something on Nintendo or Super Nintendo, you had to send Nintendo the gold master of it. And they would put it in the queue to get printed. Like, you couldn't just sort of set up. There were some companies that were allowed to do that, but I'm sure there are some recalled games. I've definitely played fundamentally broken Nintendo games that were just
Dr. Jekyll.
Just unplayable. But
yeah, I think that stopped a lot of it, though, is that people knew that, like, we would have to recall our games if there was a problem, so we better make sure there's no problems, you know? Whereas now people are just like, the Assassin's Creed Unity, his face is gone. It's like, yeah, we'll patch it later.
Well, now people are like, we got Diablo 3, got to log in to play my single-player offline experience.
Yeah. Well, also, games are significantly more complicated now, so there's just the chance. You know, every time you write a line of code, there's a chance that, however small, that something will go wrong.
You don't have to tell me.
Yeah, that's why I said you knew.
Yeah, I know. I know.
But, you know, like, I'd be curious what the just lines of code of like Legend of Zelda is compared to Ocarina of Time, compared to Twilight Princess.
Oh, I'm sure it's it's probably like leveled off by now. It's one of those like curves that's exponential for a minute, and then it kind of slows down.
Yeah, it slows down. Yeah, I could see that. My only kind of last thought, right, and this is more of a problem that we have now, so it wouldn't be fixed regardless, but so in this world of like this one system, do you see it being digital or physical or both?
Both?
Like still making discs?
I think that the reality is upon us that let's say the 4.5 is a real thing, right?
Yeah.
I see that being the last device that comes with a drive. And I say this all the time about the Xbox One. There was a lot of talk about how like people just weren't ready in the console space for these kind of advancements and consoles, you know, no disk drive, being connected to the internet. That wasn't the issue. The issue wasn't that the Xbox One, you know, might not be able to take physical discs or whatever. Mm-hmm. The issue was that every single design decision that was made for the Xbox One was for the publisher's benefit and not the consumer's.
Yeah.
Every single one. So you talk about, well, you have to be connected online to play your games. That's not a consumer benefit. Oh, well, no, you don't have to be connected. You just have to check in every 24 hours. That's not a consumer benefit. Mm-hmm. You know, it was all to protect the ownership of the IP. That was the big issue. So if they would have come out and been like, hey, we're creating the iPhone of games and your Xbox Live account, you know, is going to be connected to this, and when you download a game, and when you download digital games, they're going to be cheaper because they don't have to be manufactured. I don't think people would have had an issue with that. Now, there are plenty of places in the U.S. that don't have the internet necessary.
That's the problem.
To do it.
I grew up in one of those places, yeah. You know?
But in the next 8 years...
Yeah, hopefully.
You know, that could be different. And the truth is, like, Sony and Microsoft at some point might have to make a decision and be like, I'm sorry you live in a shitty area, but we're not going
to just like move to the city.
I mean,
call the Tennessee Valley
Authority. Apple has laptops that haven't had disk drives in them for what, 5 years, 6 years?
Yeah.
I took my DVD drive out of my laptop and replaced it with another hard drive because I never put discs in there.
Yeah, for sure.
We have the smart drive thing connected to the iMac. I think I've put one CD in there since we've owned that computer. So, like, now obviously we're in Columbus, Ohio. Better internet, whatever.
More IPs.
Yeah, but the more IPs. But the point stands that at some point, the cost of putting that, like, would you buy a PS4 without a disk drive if it meant it cost $50 less?
Probably not. I'm not going to lie. No.
But would you buy a PS5 without a disk drive?
If it
costs $50 less, you would go for the disk drive?
Wait, if that's the only option?
Let's say there were two options. Hypothetically, there's one without a disk drive and one with it, and the one without the disk drive's $50 less.
I'd still buy the disk drive.
Why?
Because I can make that $50 up just buying physical games. Like, so here's the thing, right? The reason why Steam works so great is that Steam sales are, like, famous, right?
Sure.
The console doesn't have something like that. PlayStation's trying with their flash sales or whatever.
But when it comes down to PS Plus?
PlayStation Plus, you get free games. But here's the thing. I can go right now to a store. I can go right now on my PS4 and buy Dark Souls 3 for $60, right?
Sure.
Or I can go to Best Buy and buy it for $48.
Okay.
So overall, like me buying, well, that, I like to buy discs.
Well, but that has to do more with the merchant mechanism than anything else.
Are you able to install it in a way where you don't need the disc anymore?
No, and I mean that's the main thing. But I don't mind putting in discs. Like that doesn't bother me.
But what if you could buy the download code from Best Buy for $45?
Sure. But
it's not a physical product now. It's you're just getting the code.
So that's my main thing, right? I could probably pretty easily cut ties with physical products, right? I still buy Blu-rays and DVDs, for God's sake. Like, I like to have discs.
You're a monster.
I know. I like to have discs. Like, when it comes down to it, I like using
you
discs.
You like to have stuff.
I like to have stuff, yeah.
And I get it. I like to have stuff, too.
Yeah. The biggest reason why I haven't switched to digital is because when it comes down to it, I've bought games digital before. I bought one of the Call of Duties on digital. I have traded in every other Call of Duty game because I don't care, but that one I'm stuck with. And, you know, that's another problem and whatever. But, you know, if I wanted to trade in a game, I can. And then when it comes down to it, like, I can find physical
copies. You can
copies.
For now.
For now, yeah.
But, I mean, those kind of trade-in places are going the way of the Dodo, too. That may not be the case in 6 years.
Who knows? And, you know, but that's a very small percentage of why I like to have physical media, right? Mm-hmm. The biggest percentage is that, case in point, while we were getting the podcast ready, I saw an ad that the new Danganronpa game is like $20 at Best Buy right now. Right?
Which new one?
Ultra Despair Girls. It's like a weird third-person shooter.
I can't handle these Japanese games, man. Yeah. I never know what's
it's,
called.
It's
what.
Like it's a spinoff. It's called Ultra okay. Despair Girls. It's not like Danganronpa 3. So there's Danganronpa 1, Danganronpa 2, and then Danganronpa Ultra, another episode, Ultra Despair Girls. It's crazy. Anyway, that game is still $40 on the PlayStation Vita store, right? And for the Vita, I have essentially gone all digital. Like, mm-hmm. I like having digital. I don't want to keep on changing discs, all that kind of stuff.
Okay.
But I can get it for half off if I just drive to Best Buy. You know, now if this is a system where Best Buy just starts selling codes and you get the normal sales that you would,
like you get it for half. Physical, it's a $60 game.
It's a $40 game that is $20 at Best Buy right now.
Okay, so how long does it take you to drive to Best Buy?
4 minutes.
It's not 4 minutes.
It's 4 minutes. From
it
my
is
house.
Not 4 minutes.
It is 4 minutes to drive.
Nothing
to Best Buy
in
house.
The world. Me going and getting up to use the bathroom is going to take more than 4 minutes.
You didn't ask how long it takes. You said you asked how long does it get you to get to Best Buy.
How long does it take you from the moment you saw that ad to get out of your house, get in your car, drive to Best Buy, go find the game, stand in line, pay for it, and drive back? At least half an hour. At least half an hour.
I also live 4 minutes from Best Buy.
At least half an hour.
You underestimate Cody's enthusiasm for purchasing
I know.
And spending money.
It's the same. This is the same thing when we have conversations about like how long is it going to take to code this feature. And you're like 20 minutes, and like 2 hours later you're like 20 minutes. Everything always takes longer than you think it would.
I feel you. My point is half an hour.
It costs you time and gas to do that.
Yeah, sure.
You probably lost close to $20 in time and gas.
I doubt that.
Just doing it. Your time's worth something. You
Cody
know?
Was going to Best Buy anyway. He was already.
That's the thing. I was already on my way there.
But anyway, like, you know, the argument is like, at best, you might net out.
Yeah.
In the time,
because Cody was actually driving to Best Buy when he saw the ad.
Yeah.
Well, maybe that's
did you know?
If you were in Best Buy looking at the ad, then I would agree.
I mean, it's one of those things. It's one of those things. Again, this is the nice thing. If I was still living on campus, I would 100% agree with you, right? If I was living on campus and we were located on campus.
Sure.
The difference is that when I was living on campus and we were in Dublin, I'd pass a Best Buy, right? Uh-huh. So I could just, on my way to work, I'd make a stop. It'd add 20, 15 minutes to my drive. Carry on, right?
Yeah.
Now I can, like, on my way to the gym, stop at Best Buy. On my way home from the gym, stop at Best Buy. You know, I have, sure. You know, my routes go through Best Buy anyway.
All roads lead to Best Buy.
You've centered Best Buy in your life. You picked, Chris, you picked the worst example for, like...
Whatever. The fact remains that we are moving towards a digital...
I agree.
So what more than likely is going to end up happening is this decision is going to be made for you.
Yeah, and that's fine. Again... It's not the fact that I am like adamantly against digital. I like digital games.
Sure.
My Vita is almost all digital.
And again, you're talking to a guy who like I still own all my Super Nintendo games and like I keep them all.
My Genesis games are
my N64 years. Stuff's sitting over there. Like
yeah, no, I feel you. I'm of the same mind, right? Eventually, we will have to go digital. I will make the jump to digital when I start seeing things that when I start seeing kind of the money saving opportunities that currently I can get through physical. You know what I mean? I can buy a physical copy of a game a month after launch for half off because people just want it off the store shelves, right?
And then resell it eventually for a chunk of that.
Yeah. So, I mean, and that's my main thing. And, like, you know, will that change eventually? Yes. Am I okay with that? Yes. Like, that's... I'm completely fine with going to an all-digital kind of plane and... doing all that, not having to get up and change my discs or not having to leave my house or whatever. That's fine. I'm cool with that. It's just, for me, the biggest decision right now is that I can get games off the top. And to make a counterexample, I can go and buy Dark Souls 3 off of Amazon right now. And sure, I have to wait 2 days to play it, which is worth something in and of its own. But, you know, I can get it for cheaper than what I can buy it for digitally through two different platforms, depending on how lazy I'm feeling.
But, I mean, that's not really a counter. Again, that has more to do with the merchanting mechanism. Mm-hmm. Like,
well, and they're just like,
what,
it.
Again, because they do that 20% discount or whatever mm-hmm. through Amazon. What if they just gave you a code and you can do it right then?
Sure, but they don't. If they did, I would totally buy digital.
Okay.
That's the thing. Like, you know what I mean? It's all about, like, where can I get the cheapest version of this game? I'm very happy to, like, you know, if I'm looking into a game, if I'm like, oh, you know what? I really want Mortal Kombat X, right? And I can look at it. I can either buy it from, you know, Amazon or Best Buy for 20, or it's on a flash sale from PlayStation for 10 bucks. Like, I'm buying it for 10 bucks.
Sure.
You know? That's how I make my purchasing decisions. If it gets to a point where digital is hitting cheaper than physical should, which we should be there. It physically takes less money to make a digital game. The reason why they don't do it is because they don't want their retailers to be pissed at them who sell the hardware.
Sure.
But when we get to the point that digital games are consistently cheaper than physical games, you're damn right I'm switching.
Yeah.
Like, that's the reason.
I mean, that's at some point that's going to happen. At some point, both Sony and Microsoft, they may even get together, if it's not considered collusion, they may get together in a room and be like, are we ready to tell Walmart and GameStop and Best Buy that...
They can have download codes, but that's about it.
Yeah, like, they can keep working however they want to create their model, but we're going to start selling our stuff online for cheaper.
Yeah.
And they need to figure out a way to deal with it.
And when it comes down to it, Amazon, Best Buy, they already sell codes. You know what I mean? Like, you can go to Amazon right now and buy Pokemon Yellow for the 3DS for 10 bucks, right? And they give you a code for Pokemon Yellow. It's no different than if you were to just go to the eShop, other than you bought it through Amazon instead of Nintendo.
Yeah. No, I get it.
So, I mean, like, we already have those systems in effect. Yeah. I mean, that's the thing for me.
In a Mass Effect?
Oh. Da, da, da.
That was my Tom.
We're running out of time here.
All right. So let's jump in. I think.
Wow. Yeah, we are out of time here.
How can we be out of time?
We're at 56 minutes.
That's fine. We're going to keep on trucking.
We're going to keep trucking.
Yeah.
Right through the Silicorn
Valley. I've still got another 15 minutes. I want to talk about Doughnut Drake real fast.
All right. Hold on. I got this ready to go. So let me just go ahead. I'm going to introduce Doughnut Drake the only way I know how, which is showing everybody what Doughnut Drake is.
With a donut?
Yeah. So I guess...
Do you know what Doughnut Drake is?
I have no idea what Doughnut Drake is.
Okay, this is great. So, I guess spoilers for the opening of Uncharted 3.
Oh, no, don't. I don't want to know.
It's a straight-up tutorial.
I don't want to know. I don't want to know.
This video...
Find another video, Doughnut Drake.
I like this video. Like,
he's in every game. You should be able to find one.
But this one's so perfect.
Oh, no. No, I can't. I'm right there, man.
But that video length was choice.
Choice. Making everything complicated. Doughnut Drake. I'm just going to ruin Uncharted 2.
Doughnut. Doughnut.
The Doughnut Drake collection.
That's a parody.
A tribute to Doughnut Drake. There you go.
There we go. Fine.
So here's
Doughnut Drake. This will probably spoil more of the games for you than...
Oh, look at that.
So that's Doughnut Drake.
Did they redo his voice or...
Yeah. They just took the voice and they like made it lower.
Like a little bit.
Yeah.
Clipping through that belly.
See, that's a spoiler of Uncharted 3.
How many games can you
make?
No,
that was Uncharted.
A Drake.
Look at that.
Once,
that's a spoiler of Uncharted 3.
How many Uncharted games can you make Drake look like this in?
Three. It's in all of them so far.
Wow.
So this is yeah.
This is really amazing.
It's so good.
Whoa, this guy is pretty strong.
My personal favorite is that.
See, this is pretty good.
See, Doughnut Drake's great. I love Doughnut Drake.
This is one.
How does this guy live this lifestyle? Oh, jeez.
Oh, my God. That's pretty good. That is pretty.
Oh, man.
It should have been like a high-speed running scene.
Oh, wait.
So the announcement is that they've decided to remove it from Uncharted 4.
You can't make Doughnut Drake?
They got rid of Doughnut Drake.
You cannot play Doughnut Drake.
Why would anyone play that game?
So here's what I think is interesting is this a sign of the sort of industry maturing? And Neil Druckmann has pretty much stated that it just they don't think it adds any value and they don't want to make fun of people.
Yeah.
So obviously, like, it was meant as sort of lowbrow, just kind of funny humor. It wasn't meant to, like, really poke fun at anyone.
Yeah.
But they sat around and they kind of thought about it. And I guess they're like, you know what? It's just not, like, I get the joke, but it really doesn't add any value to the game.
I mean, so I never played Uncharted with Doughnut Drake, right? Like, I knew of Doughnut Drake. I like it because, again, when I think of Uncharted, I think of kind of campiness and just being silly.
Yeah.
And, you know, of course, there is kind of the idea of, like, having a morbidly obese Drake, you know, like, that does kind of... It is funny because it is funny that, oh, hey, look at that fat guy, you know, run and jump across things that he shouldn't be able to. So, like, I get it, right, that it's not funny. But at the same time, like, the only way to unlock Doughnut Drake is to beat the game, and you don't have to play as him. So, like, you know, if it was if with them making the call, like, that's fine. That's totally fine. They just didn't want to put it in. I agree. Where I would have gotten mad is if people got mad about having that in there.
I'm letting Cody speak. I'm being a quiet, thoughtless, respectful listening person.
No, I agree. It's like 80s movies.
Yeah.
Like, I love 80s movies, but when you go back and watch a lot of them, you're just like, oh man, that would not fly today.
Yeah, totally.
and it's the one thing where it's like you're making a joke and it's funny, and it's not necessarily directly at the expense of somebody.
Yeah.
But you realize that the context of the joke, like, it only works if it's referential against, you know, X, that thing is. And so, like, when you make, like, an Asian joke or whatever, like, it only works because you're acknowledging sort of the stereotype of, you know, whatever the Asian stereotype is going to be. Like, that's the only way the joke works, right?
No, I agree.
I mean, in this case, this isn't saying that morbidly obese people can do anything they want to.
I mean, yeah, you could definitely reshape it that way. I mean,
the thing I
like about Doughnut Drake is this. I just love the way he looks. Like, he looks like this just, like, happy, chipper.
Yeah.
He's, like, ready to take... like, in that last scene where he's smiling.
Doughnut Drake is great.
Yeah.
Like, does this mean that in the new Uncharted, you basically can't customize Drake at all?
I don't know. So, they've always had in the Uncharted games where you can, like, change his clothes, right? Like, you can unlock different outfits. Or, you know, they have, I think in Uncharted 2, where are you at in Uncharted 2?
I'm halfway through.
What just happened?
Killing bad guys. I just finished the Light Temple. So don't do any spoilers if it's going to be one. If there's a potential, it's going to be one.
Have you run into new people with your group?
Yes.
Okay. Do you know who Jeff is?
Is he the camera guy?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. So in Uncharted 2, you can play as Jeff. Like, you can unlock a skin.
Wait, you can
Jeff.
Play as Jeff?
You can play as Jeff. Jeff? Yeah. Like, that's just how campy. Like, you can choose. Like, essentially, there's just reskins. I think you can play as Elena and Chloe and stuff as well.
Okay.
But
same voice?
I don't know. I've actually never played. Never I wouldn't played as assume Jeff. So. I'd assume as Jeff, you can play. Like, it's just Drake's voice.
Yeah.
But Jeff's body. But... I forgot where I was going. Yeah, those have been in all the games.
Yeah, it's just something about. So when I teach class, the video game design class, one of the things I say when it comes to comedy, the two things that tend to work the best are when you're self-deprecating.
Yep,
I got that one on lock.
Yeah, we do.
And if you're gonna poke fun at people, poke up. So on the power scale, poke up. Like, it's less fun to make fun of, like, a transgender guy. Like, oh, I get it. Or, like, oh, let's say a flamboyant gay guy. Like, he's being flamboyant. It's funny because that's what he's doing.
Yeah.
But, like, at some point, you're just like, okay, that joke. Like, that's the joke. That's it. That's all you got.
That homeless person is poor.
Yeah. Exactly. But it's a lot. If you can, when you poke up on the power scale, like, I think you can make more interesting both jokes and commentary if that's your desire. But that being said, too, like, sometimes you can just... South Park, I mean, their entire shtick is that they poke fun at everyone for everything.
I like that a lot about South Park.
So you can do that. But again, Uncharted is not South Park.
Yeah, totally. So, there's, I think South Park is the only thing that can get away with that. And, like, I guess Saints Row.
Because they also poke fun at themselves.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
Because they're included in their own set of targets.
Yeah, totally.
Well, I just want to kind of bring that up because I thought it was interesting. And I think that video is...
The video is great.
As an unexpected treat.
That video before it was really good, too.
Yeah.
But it's not... That's comedically timed and stuff. But a lot of the video I was going to show was in that video.
Okay. I'm just saying.
You didn't even know.
I had no idea that was a thing.
But that was pretty good.
Yeah. I'm going to have to watch more Doughnut Drake videos.
All right. So we're going to do one last thing as our main thought.
Yeah, because we haven't even hit main thoughts yet.
We haven't yet, but we're not gonna talk as long about it. Because we've had some pretty good, I think, interesting discussions on this one. But our main thought is going to be Silicon Valley. So, for those of you who know us at MVG and all the things that we're involved in, our ultimate goal, like, we love making games and we work on projects with clients and stuff, but, like, our ultimate goal is to make this area like the Silicon Valley for video games, to like build that ecosystem. And I've got all my buzzwords about like hotspot for video games and turning a community into an industry and
three pillars,
whatever. But you know, just the Silicon Valley of video games, and that's really really what we're shooting for. And I think we can do it, and I'm super excited about it. And stuff like Patreon is a part of that. You know, being able to provide funding so we can start to do these things. Because the more eyeballs that we get in the area, the more success we're going to have, the more likely we are to reach out past, you know, Columbus and Ohio. Mm-hmm. So, like, with, like, Unity, for example, them seeing all the cool stuff we're doing at the expo gets them excited and wants to have them involved. And, you know, we don't really have, like, any big announcements or anything about this other than, like, this is our endeavor for 2016 is to make this place internationally known for video games.
And internationally known as Silicon Valley.
Silicon Valley.
Yep. It's a pretty corny joke.
And hopefully we get some like serious usage of like corn-derived ethanol in the construction of video game consoles so that we can start a whole corn...
So we're just using that as an affectionate title. We're not actually calling anything that.
We're going to get a whole corn tech vertical stack.
Like, should we have Katie whip up a logo?
Yeah.
Corn and technology.
A corn stalk playing a video game.
Yeah.
We can go to Dublin where they have the corn garden or
the
whatever.
The cement corn.
Called. Yeah.
Yeah, it's like every time you talk to somebody from outside Ohio... And they're like, oh, you know, you got cows and corn. And you're like, actually, no, we're the 15th largest city in the country and huge tech infrastructure, giant universities. And then Dublin goes ahead and, like, makes a friggin' corn statue. And you're like, oh,
God damn it.
You're killing us.
You're thinking of Iowa.
Does that count as poking up?
Yeah. I don't even know what that
means. Anything you can make fun of Dublin for is poking up because those people are hot heat.
But anyway... I think that's super exciting. Like, we've been working on this for 5 years, going into year six, and we're just going to keep pushing to do it, talking to city leaders, state leaders, investors, and of course having everyone from the community, like, being a part of this, like, growing the expo every year, making it wicked cool.
Are you just getting stoked for Boston?
Yeah.
Are you wicked slowly
cool? I'm going to go to that seafood place.
Wicked awesome.
I'm saving like $100 just so I can have a meal at that seafood place.
Hey, you know, Boston Market in Boston.
It's expensive.
Damn,
I think when we went, it was easily $70 or $80 a person.
I'll say I want some good lobster mac and cheese, but not for that. I'll go get lobster mac and cheese at like a corner, some street food.
Well, maybe we can sweet sock some Bostonian into giving us money. We can go and eat.
Tyler.
So anyway, that's it. I don't know if there's any thoughts on that.
No. I mean, it's the same thing that we've been going after for years now. We want to make this place the place.
Mm-hmm. Can we take that one speech of Jobs that you showed us and cut in your face for Jobs' face, and every time he says Silicon, we splice in you saying Silicorn.
Yeah.
But otherwise, it's the same identical
speech. Exactly. And then at the end, we'll just transition in the Gladiator, and I get eaten by a tiger.
Yeah.
It's all about the beehive.
But anyway, we're sort of running out of time, so let's indie spotlight The Pedestrian.
Yeah.
Check it out. It's been Steam greenlit.
It's going to be at PAX.
You get to be a pedestrian?
No. It's a cool puzzle game. It's really good looking.
Yeah.
And they went to the expo last year. Cool group of guys. So I would check that out. I think they're planning on a June or July release. And I don't think they're going to do early access. But if you go on to Steam, you can like it and then get the updates.
Yeah, I think you can follow it. Right, Tom? You're kind of the Steam expert here.
Can you follow games on the Steams?
Put it on your wish list.
Okay. Yeah. Can you do that with Greenlight?
I think you can put Greenlight games on your wish list. You can follow Greenlight games.
Yeah. Okay, yeah, that's what I thought. Okay.
Yeah, that's right. You can follow Greenlight games, and if it's on Steam proper, you can put it on your wish list, and it'll tell you when there's a sale. That's always. I got a lot of games on my wish list that I kind of watch out for big sales and stuff.
Yeah,
cool.
With that being said, they are getting ready to start beta soon, so I can't make any promises, but email us at WMVG@multivariousgames.com if you like how The Pedestrian looks, and maybe we can get you in the beta.
Yeah, or at least follow them on their Facebook and Twitters and whatnot.
Yeah,
we got clout.
Tell them. That's made by Skookum Arts, S-K-O-O-K-U-M.
We've got clout.
Yep, clout. All right, well, that's been episode 81 of WMVG, the weekly Multivarious Games podcast.
Heck yeah.
As always, you can find us on the iTunes, where you can download the podcast. You can find us on the web at multivariousgames.com. You can find us on Facebook, Multivarious Games. You can find us on Twitter, at Multivarious. You can find me personally on Twitter at C_Mulby. You can find Cody at Cody Was Here, with Was being W-U-Z. And you can find Tom at Argenbarger. As Cody mentioned, you can also email us, WMVG@multivariousgames.com. We'll check it. We'll read it online. If you have a question about anything we've talked about, or just have a question about games development, or what we're going to try to do with this Silicon Valley idea, feel free to ask. We'll update you as often as we can with all the cool stuff we have coming up. I guess we should mention, too, if you are listening to our podcast and you want to exhibit at GDEX, The applications are open. So it's bit.ly/exhibit-GDEX-2016, all lowercase.
Yeah.
So if you go there, you can fill in an application. It'll come to us. We'll peruse it. And if you get approved, you can go and buy all your booths and tickets and whatever.
Who is slacking me?
But
before you do that, Chris, what's your plan?
Uncharted 2.
Yeah,
and
Tom.
And Danganronpa.
Tom, what you playing?
Fallout 4 and New Vegas.
Nice.
Cody, what you playing?
I'm playing Uncharted 3.
Lame.
And Pokemon Yellow.
Lame.
Sweet. Well, anyway, thanks for listening, and we will see you next week.
Send us hate mail, and I'll read it live on the show.
And then cry. And then
no,
we'll print it out and he can use it to wipe off his tears.
I'm not going to cry.
Baby's like buried in here.
I'm not sleepy time. In fact, I'm probably going to think it's hilarious. So
cool.
So do it.
All right. Well, thanks, Lee. See you
thanks,
other
Lee.
Time. Bye.
Thanks, Dot Lee.
Thanks, Dot Lee. Bit.ly/thanks.
That's probably all going in the back. So we're good.
All right, cool.